You are now listening to Extreme Cinema with Andrew Ganke and David Lawler. If you like sex and violence, evil brunettes, and angelic blondes, then stick with us as we debate some of the best and worst of action and exploitation filmmaking.
Here we are again, nauseating you with another episode of Extreme Cinema, Action and Exploitation Movies with Andrew Ganke and David Lawler. That's me. Tonight,
that's
my
me.
Stars, but we have two movies directed by John McNaughton. Welcome home, Roxy Carmichael, and How to Make an American Quilt.
I'm young. I'm supposed to do foolish things.
Henry, Portrait of a Serial Killer, and The Borrower. Daylight savings time tonight. Don't forget, Andrew. The clocks go which way? I forget.
I don't know. It's spring ahead, fall back. So it's
so we got to fall down. We got to fall into fall.
Don't waste my motherfucking time.
All right, I have a little story before we begin. Since we're going to talk about gory stuff, I had a really gory episode a couple of days ago. When I'm sitting at my podcasting station here in the Queen's Kitchen, no matter where I serve my guests, it seems they like the kitchen best. Sushi jumps on my lap. The other night, she lost her footing and she slipped and grabbed hold of my leg and pulled with her claws.
Just for everybody out there, Sushi is his mail order bride from Japan.
Yes, that's exactly what Sushi is. Yes, it's a little gray tabby. Anyway, I'll post the picture.
You can order mail order brides in any colors that you want. They even come in little gray tabbies.
Yes, you can order mail order kittens from Russia too. And the great thing is they get on your computer and start hacking. That's a really bad Letterman impersonation I was doing there.
Yeah, the Democrats start using them as an excuse. With all those Russian cats that are
Russian
like releasing
kittens
our
are
email.
Trying to sabotage our election.
They're trying to get they're telling people who we are again. No.
Oh, no. Obviously, we just lost the satellite feed. That sucks.
Anyway, long story short, I look like a self-mutilator below the waist. You should see these scratches. Suchi, Portrait of a Serial Kitten.
I don't care!
What would you little maniacs like to do first?
Did you know that this movie, Henry, Portrait of a Serial Killer, still plays in theaters?
I did not know that.
Well, a quick check on the Googles reveals the landmark Sunshine Cinema shows the movie. It's essentially like it's a midnight movie these days, but it still plays in the theaters.
Who does that? Is it like Rocky Horror Picture Show? Do they fucking dress up like Michael Rooker and go to the fucking... How does
Speaking
that
of which,
work?
Good segue there because we watched the new version of Rocky Horror today.
My condolences.
And it looks terrible. It was really terrible. It was really bad.
It's fucking awful.
It had great production value, good photography,
Dude,
and everything.
I'm kind of worried that there are people that want to go to a midnight showing of this. It's kind of it's a movie that I don't enjoy watching really.
We're talking
much
about Henry, right?
Yeah.
Okay,
no,
we're talking about Henry.
I gave up worrying about Rocky Horror Picture Show a long time ago.
Okay, this is like, it's not a movie that you're like, you got your popcorn and you're like, oh, wow, I can't wait to see this movie. This is awesome. And then you get out screaming and cheering or something. You know?
Yeah,
and
like, this is the part where they rape and kill the whole fucking family. It's awesome. You know, like, do it again. You know?
That's a good Otis impersonation.
He's laughing his sick fucking ass off.
Yeah.
I mean, doesn't it seem like Henry would be a movie made for people like Henry and Otis?
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. It's like, seriously, we should like do psychological we should follow everybody that goes to see this as a midnight movie at the theater.
I don't know.
That's just weird.
These are white people with white people's problems, you know?
Not okay!
Oh, God.
So the only other film out there that continues to generate this much of an insane midnight movie cult following is, of course,
Rocky Horror Picture Show.
No. The Sisterhood of the Traveling Pants.
Why is that so hard for me to say? I have no problem being mad at you.
Because you know I'll always love you no matter what.
Oh, of course, The Sisterhood of the Traveling Pants. Yeah.
What do we got?
Otis, plug it in.
Did you really kill your mama?
What?
Did you really kill your mama?
I guess I did.
She must have treated you real bad.
She's a whore.
Susie! Susie!
You used to dance naked?
Sure, all the time around town.
Otis.
Best little naked dancer you ever saw.
You never.
telling me you never killed anybody before?
I ain't saying that.
Open your eyes, Otis. Look at the world. It's either you or them. You know what I mean. Don't do that, Otis. She's your sister.
I feel like I know you. Like I've known you for a long time. I feel like I've known you forever and ever.
It's like the blood droppings from a deer you've shot. And all they gotta do is follow those droppings, and pretty soon they're gonna find that deer.
I ain't interrupting this, man.
What are you doing?
I don't want to see it again.
A few episodes of Extreme Cinema back, I mentioned how this is a movie I could never recommend to anybody for fear of getting funny looks from people for the rest of my life. And it's right up there with Devil's Rejects. Both of these movies for me are insanely well made, but they're extremely hard to get through for different reasons. Movies can be excellent, but almost unwatchable. Can you think of any other movies that fit that description? Are there any movies that you loved that are brilliant, but you can't really watch them? You can't sit through them.
No, Henry really is in a sort of a class by itself in that regard. I mean, there are lots of movies that I wouldn't want to sit through. We watch a lot of them these days.
Oh, yeah, yeah. No, but I'm talking about a movie that you know. Movie that, like, yes, I get it. Seen. It's a brilliant movie, but I just can't watch it. You know, okay. Like that kind of a thing. Like Schindler's List. Schindler's, I think, List. Of Schindler's, yeah, List.
See, we are really in sync. Like, what are we cycling together or something? Like,
we're cycling. We're going to have to pick out some China patterns.
Yeah.
Well, let's not start sucking each other's dicks quite yet.
Yeah, it's a brilliant movie, but it's really hard to get through. There's a couple of others, I guess, along those lines. You have these two guys, Malik and Waleed Ali, who ran MPI, which is like this very small production house and rental facility out of Chicago, and they wanted to make a quick, cheap horror movie, right? McNaughton already worked for them. He put together a documentary about Chicago gangsters, and then it wound up being successful for them, so they were going to do another documentary about wrestling, but the deal fell through. But they still had their
and
money.
They had the money. Yeah,
they had $100,000, so they said, "Let's make a quick horror movie, and we'll turn a profit very quickly."
Got fucked on that one, huh?
McNaughton was watching he was watching an episode of 2020, which profiled Henry Lee Lucas, who is this serial killer who claimed to have killed like hundreds of people, and he probably did actually. And so he decided to make a fictionalized version of him. And he co-wrote the script with this guy named Richard Fire, who also co-wrote The Borrower later on, produced by Stephen A. Jones, who also produced The Borrower. Mm-hmm. The only other adaptation he was seriously considering was, of course, The Sisterhood of the Traveling Pants.
Because you know I'll always love you no matter what.
Yes, yeah.
But they decided that was just too expensive. So the movie was shot over the course of 28 days in Chicago in the winter on such a low budget that McNaughton had to beg, borrow, steal, call in favors. He had to ask for favors from friends and family just to make the movie. And
one thing that he did say was that everybody who worked on that movie with the $100,000 they had, everybody got paid and nobody got screwed. When filming was over, everybody got what they were promised and nobody left upset.
Well, there were these three victims of Henry, and they're all essentially played by the same chick. He had a friend who just basically put makeup and different wardrobe on and covered her in blood, and she laid there dead. Like three times in the movie. Now that is a friend and an actress right there. Who does that for you? Listen, I need you to be dead again. Okay.
Right. Yeah, dead again.
All right, I'm there. Hey, man.
Yeah.
But if McNaughton waited around for additional financing, which is what all these filmmakers do, he'd still be waiting. We wouldn't have Wild Things.
Yeah. Well, gee, that'd be too bad. Yeah. But he certainly did the right thing. I mean, he did totally the right thing.
Right.
Yeah, I mean, and he ended up really, really making, I would have to say that it's really the, even though I get the impression from listening to him that he kind of like rather not talk about it anymore.
Probably not.
But I think he's aware that without it, he wouldn't have a career. But I think it really is sort of the best thing that he's done. I think it's really he hit his high point really early. Maybe a bit of beginner's luck. I don't know.
No, I wouldn't. I disagree with that notion because I do like him. I like his work as a filmmaker, except, well, I'm not a fan of Wild Things. I was just being sarcastic about that.
Yeah. I just can't imagine the world without it.
Well, there are some stunning visuals in this, and it was shot on 16 millimeter, but we get like these slow zoom out dolly shots that are like, they remind me instantly of Kubrick in A Clockwork Orange. It's like we're seeing the aftermath of incredible, horrific violence. It's extremely influential if you look at television today. I know that they are ripping off Henry these days visually. Hannibal strikes me as that, and so does a lot of the movies that inspired Hannibal were themselves inspired by Henry.
And most of that was brought on by the needs of the budget, you know, because the script was written to the budget. And so, you know, instead of showing stuff happen, they show you the aftermath and play the sounds of, you know, of somebody getting killed and show
the sounds
you
of violence. It's cheaper.
The garbage bag or the dead body or whatever.
It's like the picture tells a story, and the picture is worth millions of words just looking at it.
Check out the big brain on Brad. You're a smart motherfucker. That's right.
Yeah,
and we're left to fill in the blanks. We have to figure it out. This is like a jigsaw puzzle made of blood.
The whole movie is a fill in the blanks kind of thing because really, you know, one of the things that the movies in general do is they sort of, most of them, almost all of them, and Henry's really one of the rare exceptions. It doesn't have any morality. It doesn't have any. It doesn't tell you how to feel about
anything.
Absolutely,
there's no morality, and that's also one of the most disturbing parts of it.
Because you have to figure out for yourself how you feel about what these guys are doing. They're just showing it to you, McNaughton saying when they first screened it, people are like, "You can't do that," and like he's like, "But it's too late. We already did."
You know, so, now. I wanted to ask because this is something I still feel even today because I had to watch it, unfortunately. I had to watch it again just to refresh my memory. But when I watched it the first time and even recently now, I feel like it's almost like pornography because I feel that if I'm watching this movie and somebody comes into the room, I have to turn it off right away. I can't have my wife and daughter running around when I'm watching it.
I would definitely feel that way. Like I know that my wife would be disturbed by it. Like she would
not. This is something I don't want to. You know, you feel like what if like people that you know had spent their life watching movies like Cinderella, and then you show them a movie like this, and it's like, oh my god, you are totally destroying everything.
Yeah,
about
yeah, I know.
It's completely like it's corrupting. It's corrupting. Henry is a guy who kills everybody. And the frightful reality of it is that he does what he does for no reason. He doesn't have personal beefs with anybody, at least not until the very end of the movie. He kills indiscriminately. He brings his friend Otis in on the action. And isn't it strange that you could hook up with a like-minded character? Someone who enjoys it. He actually, and it's weird too, because Otis, as played by Tom Towse, who's really good in this also, he seems to enjoy it more than Henry. He has a very childlike view of what he does. Henry is like his Obi-Wan.
Kill this guy, would you?
Who's like sort of, you know, I mean, Otis obviously is psychotic and fucked up, but it never occurred to him to do this kind of shit. Here comes Henry. Just sort of bringing all these ideas, and he's like, yeah, let's do it. You know?
He's like, well, yeah, Henry's like his id in a way. He's like, we can do this. We don't need, you know, it could be said that maybe the id is the unrestrained urge to do whatever you want without moral consideration or anybody telling you, hey, maybe this is wrong, you know?
Right.
You kill that high school boy, they're going to slap your ass right back in jail, Otis. That's a promise. I mean, people have seen you together.
I'd still like to kill him, though.
I bet you would.
I'd like to kill somebody.
Say that again.
I'd like to kill somebody.
That's when you go.
We start off we zoom out, the way the movie begins, we zoom out from a dead naked woman in a ditch. We cut to Henry, played by Michael Rooker in his first major role, in a diner paying his check. We cut to Henry getting in his car and driving off. We cut to another couple of dead bodies, an old man and an old woman, parents of one of McNaughton's friends. We cut back to Henry driving, and we cut to another dead naked woman in a restroom with a soda bottle lodged in her mouth, which is nice. We cut back to Henry driving, and then we cut to another shot of a dead naked body in a marsh and an empty milk container floating by. That's the same chick in all those shots.
Oh, yeah.
In a parking lot, he stakes out several would-be victims, all women, and he follows this woman who's wearing sunglasses, and he follows her all the way to her house, but he drives off when he notices she has a husband. So instead, that husband probably saved her life right there, and yeah. He picks up a hitchhiker. Never hitchhike, kids. So the Sisterhood of the Traveling Pants had a very similar opening scene. One of the girls, I think, with the pants. She was. See, the thing about the pants is that they killed this man, and they've been keeping his pants.
Yeah, yeah.
That's sort of. I don't know. So he hooks up with prison buddy Otis, who deals drugs. And Tom Towles has been in just about every McNaughton movie. He's in The Borrower also. He's in Mad Dog and Glory. I think he even appears in Wild Things. I'm not sure. He was also in an episode of Seinfeld as the irate dog owner. He's a great actor.
Hi there, little doggy. Do you mind if I pet your dog?
It's okay with me.
Hey, you can't have that dog in here. You okay? Did he bite you?
Can you believe that, girl?
I'm okay. It's just a nip.
He just walked away. And once again, I'm standing here like a little man. Well, not this time.
His sister, Becky, is in town and staying with him because she ran away from her husband. And Henry and Otis find they have similar interests. So they start killing together.
Yeah, man.
And the key to Henry's approach is interesting. Don't kill any of the same type of people. Always kill people in different ways. Then the cops will have a harder time finding you.
What? What's going to happen when they find those bodies?
Nothing.
What do you mean, nothing?
Just what I said, Otis. Nothing. Nothing's going to happen because nothing happened. And I don't know nothing about it, whatever it is. Do you?
Hey, I don't know nothing.
Good.
Oh, fuck.
So does this movie, does it seem like it exists in a world where there is no law enforcement because we never see cops?
Well, I think they just never get brought into the equation.
We never see the aftermath of
really when were they going to show up? Maybe at the when he kills the motorist with the broken down car, you know?
Yeah.
Maybe there, but I mean the other ones, the other stuff that they do is really kind of out of the, you know, it's just like in the shadows and nobody's going to see it and nobody expects it, and that's what's scary about it. You know, the cops
that
aren't
going to
save
you. You don't have Radon Chong there with a gun.
No, if you don't, yeah, because Radon Chong is not there to save you, and you know,
so you're kind of on your own. There is no, you know, there's no cops to protect you. You are on your own. This is like a mad world.
I carry a gun because I can't carry a Radon Chong with me everywhere I go.
Even though I'd love to.
Keep one of them.
This is like what I said, but a weave world. It's a world of pure id, no sanity. It's all chaos and the fact that there is no morality. Henry and Becky like each other, obviously, and Otis knows it. Otis is a very disturbed individual. He's written at least as a latent homosexual, and he entertains an infatuation with Henry.
A little more than latent, because he's touching on guys. And actually, there's actually a gay love scene between Henry and Otis that's cut out of the movie.
I never heard anything about a gay scene. All I saw, there was one scene where he tried to... wasn't there one bit where he tried to kiss Henry?
He's a fag!
Or am I thinking of something else?
I think he did try. He might have tried to kiss Henry. Or
whenever he's close to him, have you noticed? I mean, like he's close to him, he looks like he wants to kiss him.
Yeah, and he tries to touch that dude that he's selling the drugs to.
Yeah.
And
that guy punches him or something. He also has a fixation on controlling his sister. in one of the more disturbing scenes.
He wants to fuck his sister too. So like,
yeah, I know. Well, what could that possibly be? I mean, is he experiencing some level of homosexual based frustration? Mm-hmm. Now, I wonder. You know, I hate. You know, once again, we talked about how disturbing it is to actually go to a midnight movie presentation of this and to have like a cult of really, you know.
Dude, that's
fans.
So fucked up. I don't want to know anybody who does that.
But can
who
you knows? Imagine, is it possible that a movie like this could inspire people? I don't want to be one of these assholes, but, you know, I mean, we talk about A Clockwork Orange, you talk about Natural Born Killers. Could people watch this and get some ideas? Because he is actually dispensing some really good advice about how not to get caught, you know?
Yeah. I mean, but, you know, anybody who's probably really thought about it, you know, in actual like with an eye towards doing it, has probably come up with something. I mean, it's not, this is not a brilliant guy. I mean, you know, he's not like earth shakingly intelligent. You know,
he's smart enough to stay ahead of any kind of police action.
If I was a mass murderer, I'd be Mickey and Mallory.
Two of their biggest fans were Ben and Sarah. They followed the same script on a journey that left one man dead in Oklahoma and 35-year-old Patsy Byers paralyzed in Louisiana. When they confessed to this copycat crime, Patsy shot back in court. In addition to Ben and Sarah, Patsy sued Oliver Stone and Time Warner for producing a film designed to glorify and incite violence.
Well, look, if you're looking to do the kind of killing that he's doing, you know, it's not that hard to make the leap to coming up to doing it his way, really, if you're just thinking about it. If you're that kind of psycho. And really, I think that if there's somebody there's nobody that's going to be made into that kind of psycho by getting the idea from Henry a Portrait of a Serial Killer.
Well, not in our position. Not in our position. Because
no, not in
anyone's
position.
Well, it's just the way I look at it. If I'm writing a script and somebody decides to imitate the behavior of a script that I wrote, I can't accept responsibility because I didn't, you know, it's not like I put the gun in the dude's hand. All I did was tell a story. There's plenty of violence out there to feast on.
Anybody who does that is already fucked up from some other reason. You're not the one that made it.
Yeah, I agree. You're
not
psycho
the one that made that
too.
Guy a psychopath.
Mean,
like they're a psychopath, and then they saw your movie
as well. You know, they've always been out there. And yes, it's not a responsibility. Good parenting will help.
Yeah,
you know, I mean, it's like you know, have a mother and father who love you. Maybe,
yeah,
then
that does
you won't
help.
Go out and try to kill people or something.
Yeah.
There was a funny story that I had picked up on recently. It was Jeffrey Dahmer. When Jeffrey Dahmer was confessing to his crimes, he did not want anyone to ever infer that he was racist, just because the majority of his victims were young black men, basically. He said that's because it's where he lived. Okay, he lived in that area, so he picked up a lot of young black men. He didn't want anyone to think that he was racist. He would rather have people believe the truth, which is that he was a murderer who ate his victims, rather than them thinking that he was racist.
God, he was ahead of his time, huh?
I ate his liver with some fava beans and a nice Chianti.
It's pretty fantastic, actually, in a sad, sick, disturbing way. But
yeah.
Okay, let's get to the ending, which is really very. It's dark. It's depressing. God, this is just a really depressing movie.
It's not a fun movie to watch, which is why I just
it's not like
didn't want to go there.
Like, watching a rape on a big screen is kind of all right. Henry comes
and I've
home.
Never seen it in HD either, and I really am not looking forward. I wasn't looking forward.
It would be interesting to see how it transfers because usually most of the copies that we look at are very murky.
Yeah, and I mean I saw it on VHS. I haven't seen it since then.
Yeah, yeah. So Henry comes home to find Otis is raping Becky, his own sister. He kills Otis. What happens is I think he's defending Becky. He's attacking Otis, mm-hmm. trying to stab him or something, and Otis is stabbing him back. Becky picks up like this metal comb and shoves it in Otis's eye, so she's technically the one who killed him.
Yeah, really bad fake dummy anyway, so nobody...
Yeah, well, that... Yeah, there's a close-up of his head.
Adios, motherfucker!
Oh,
again, $100,000, you can't go wrong.
I know. I'm just, no. I mean, they did a great job with what but they had. I'm just.
There was a good, no, they did a great job in a few minutes, in a few seconds, where he dismembers his body, and it does look pretty realistic. And he puts everything in a garbage bag, and then Becky says they should call the cops, and he tells her that would be a mistake, and she doesn't know why. She's obviously unaware of Henry's hobbies. So they steal away into the night, and they rent a motel room where we can only assume that he kills her and dismembers her body because he leaves a big suitcase by the side of the road and drives off by himself. The ending was shot and ultimately discarded for the Sisterhood of the Traveling Pants.
I'm mad. Oh, my God. Why is that so hard for me to say? I have no problem being mad at you.
Because you know I'll always love you no matter what.
They remember it was either Amber Tamblyn or America Ferrera who chopped this guy's head off, and they left him on the side of the road.
Sing the praises of pants.
One thing we haven't discussed is how this movie, which is really another really interesting facet of this movie, is the disaster that it was in terms of being able to get released, and it languished. It basically got saddled with an X rating. It was made in 1986. It didn't get any distribution because it was just, it was going to get an X rating.
Yeah, I think it eventually got its release in 1990, right?
Yeah, 90 or it maybe had, even 91. It says 90 on IMDb, but hell, it says The Borrower shot in Chicago, and that's L.A. and The Borrower. So anyway,
the parts of The Borrower on exteriors were shot in L.A., but a lot of it was shot
some of it, and it was all edited, and yeah, but we'll get into that. But in any case, it doesn't mention L.A. in there.
That's why McNaughton is like a career delayed, because every movie he made was held up. I mean, like, he was already shooting and finishing The Borrower before Henry even came out.
So it was circulated on bootleg videotapes for a long time, apparently.
Yes. I know why. That's because McNaughton sent copies of the movie on VHS to local film critics.
And then, that was Scorsese saw it that way. And that was where his interest in him came for Mad Dog Glory.
Now, would you say that we could call Henry basically a slasher film, or what genre would you put it in?
I call it a character study. Okay. It was reviewed in The Reader by Jonathan Rosenbaum, and he categorized it as a slasher film and went on to give a history of slasher films, and according to him, it starts with Psycho.
Isn't that the way, though, of the movies being publicized? I had mentioned to Chuck earlier that The Loop is doing, has been talking about it, AM, The Loop 1000.
Yeah,
Buzz Killman and the other drive-in reviewer, Fitzpatrick.
Yeah, these guys, well, slasher is sort of, this is a very real film, and about real people, based on real people, whose names I won't mention, and this is, they kill randomly, they kill for reasons that I don't think anyone.
Based on truth, I mean, there are
real people who this is based upon, and I'm not going to mention their names this evening for various reasons.
Okay.
But it's based on a true story, but ever so loosely.
Which is interesting. That also, by the way, got him. He went straight into The Borrower from Henry. But all of the bullshit with the X rating started while he was shooting The Borrower. Probably.
Yeah, and he had the same problem with The Borrower too, which is
Atlantic failed. He got fired, he got rehired, it's a big fucking mess with The Borrower.
I think what happened is that the Ali brothers, when they saw the movie, they were like, "Oh my God, this is not what we wanted." Because I saw the movie, the first time I saw it was on a rented videotape, MPI home video, and there was a trailer on the tape for a movie called Death Spa. Do you remember that movie?
I do remember Death Spa, and I had that same, that was the retail copy. Yes, with like this, oh my God, Death Spa. And like, I remember the trailer, it's this really bad, like horrible looking movie, with terrible effects, and the words Death Spa keep coming out at you. Like, it's like all of a sudden they'll show some gym equipment, like crushing this porcelain head, and it'll be like, death spa, the worst.
Death spa.
And then there was blood
everywhere.
Bad acting.
Had a good cast, though. It had Brenda Backey, Merrick Buttrick, and a couple other people on it. Actually, a couple of names in there, which is funny. And then...
Death spa. Welcome to the health club where you'll sweat blood.
Never work without a spotter, Freddy. Weight falls on your chest and you can really get squashed.
It's the place for a killer workout. An unquiet spirit reaches out from beyond the grave.
Welcome to my party.
For revenge. Yana! Death Spa. An exercise in terror.
But they show some naked chick, and then it's like, death spa!
This is exactly what they wanted. They wanted something cheesy and gory. They didn't want, you know.
But
actually, if you look at Death Spa now, I was looking at it the other day because I was reading an article about it, and the filmmakers were like, no, this is satire. We were trying to make a comment about, you know, the exercise boom in the 80s. And if you look at it with that kind of a mindset, it's a lot better than a horror.
Yeah, I'll get right on that. Well, another fun fact is that they had to cut a ton of shit out of Henry, Portrait of a Serial Killer, because it was too funny. And it was disturbing even more when you're laughing at shit when they're like killing people.
Are you talking about like maybe like the scene where they kill that TV guy?
Well, there's that, and
that's kind of funny. I'm sorry, but it is.
I know
funny.
There is that, but then there was
like Otis, plug it in, and he's like, oh, okay.
What's the matter? You got shit in your ears? The black and white is $50. Take it or leave it.
Sorry, we wasted your time. Come on, Otis.
Don't give me sorry, you dumbass. Did I stutter? Give me the $50 and get out.
Don't give you. Otis, plug it in.
Yeah. There was another one where there's one, a continuation where Otis shoots the man who pulls over to help on Lower Wacker Drive.
You guys need me help? Otis, do you need some help, or can you do it yourself?
After killing him, Otis places the gun in the man's hand, gleefully telling Henry that it'll look like suicide, even though the man has been shot twice in the head, in the chest, and once in the face.
Uh-oh.
The scene was removed because it was considered to be too laugh-out-loud funny.
Oh, no. Obviously, we just lost the satellite feed. That sucks.
And there are a few of these scenes that were removed because they were too comical. There's another one where Henry and Otis beat up a guy that was going to try and rape Becky.
Mm-hmm.
And they throw him out of a window.
Mm-hmm.
And so there's a few like scenes that were kind of, you know, humorous, and they had to get rid of them because the tone was just too fucked up.
It was just too over the top. Like McNaughton was like, this is not the kind of movie I'm trying to make. I'm an artist.
No, we're not having fun here.
I think the Ollies, what they wanted was just they had no intention of releasing the film to theaters. Just like they wanted to do straight to video, and they didn't even want to, because it costs a lot of money. They had to send that to the MPA like 5 or 6 times.
Oh yeah,
and
it cost them a fucking fortune in the short term.
$2,500 back then, because I did that one with one movie, and it was like $2,000, because they do it on a budget basically. If you have like a low budget, they'll give you a low budget rate. If you have a high budget, they'll give you a bigger rate. You know,
fucking ball washing.
I know, ball washing. Absolutely. Yeah. All of them. Fuck you, MPA. Fuck you.
Fuck you. Yeah, that's my message for you. Fuck you and kiss my ass.
Kiss my ass.
So it's meant to be like a throwaway, no budget piece of shit that would turn a quick profit and then disappear. Yeah. And that didn't happen. So now, when did you start hearing about the movie?
When it was released. I had not heard about it before then. And like, I wasn't big on this whole circulating of tapes thing that everybody was apparently doing, and I had no idea. Like, did you see the movie Winnebago Man, which is fucking awesome, about the guy who's, like, he was famous because they were circulating this blooper tape of him?
Oh, fuck. 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 Oh, fuck. Shit.
Tony, do me a favor, will you please?
Will you do me a kindness?
Leave.
Yeah.
I think I want to be walking in and out if you're going to fuck up and I got to come back.
I don't make any difference to me at this juncture. Thank you very much. I appreciate that, Tony. Don't slam the fucking door. No more. Now listen, I've got to give a clue here now. I don't want any more bullshit any time during the day from anyone. That includes me. It's going to be very hot. It's going to be very uncomfortable for everybody. Want anybody yelling. We get anybody yelling around here anymore today, and then the shit is going to hit the fan.
And they fit the diverse needs of a very big firm, and they fit the needs of a very diverse
buyer segment.
Why can't I remember? I wrote this stuff. Why can't I remember it?
Why don't I say it fucking right?
What does the goddamn line say, Tony? What is the goddamn line? I don't give a shit what the line is.
I fucked up the word rear. I can't even read the fucking B.O. straight.
What the fuck was that?
Yeah.
Sounds like, interesting.
He makes
a documentary?
Yeah, it's a documentary. It's a really interesting documentary. So the premise of the documentary being that this tape is getting passed around of this guy flipping out in the bloopers of this of a Winnebago sales video. And like he's getting angrier and angrier at everybody around him, and it's like the worst day of his life, and he's fucking pissed off and mean, and it's hilarious and funny and all. And so like this young filmmaker, like now, I mean, this was back in, you know, in the early 80s or something. And this young filmmaker now goes and tracks this guy down, finds him and figures out, you know, wants to know more about what happened then and who he is and what's going on with him. And like they tell that whole story. Right. And then they take him and have his movie screened for a bunch of fans. And he gets there as an old man now, gets to see how everybody like reacts to him in a positive way, which is kind of cool because he like kind of was living sort of.
This sounds fantastic. Was it just is it recent or
it's
old?
About three four years.
That sounds great. I love
it's
that
really
idea.
Good. I really enjoyable. I enjoyed it very much.
And he probably like had no idea that he was so entertaining. He was
right.
Just embarrassed at first.
He was embarrassed. He was embarrassed and was hiding. He didn't want to be.
He looks at how people
wanna,
are like really, yeah. Apparently this is like really famous and a lot of these people just love it.
Yeah, and people loved him, and like, and he didn't know. Like, he spent all this time not knowing that, and like, you know, and people like cheered him, and you know, and memorized his lines and stuff that he said, like, you know, and he had no idea that that was happening. Which
well,
is,
I got to take a look
is,
at that.
Yeah, yeah.
Now I had heard about it, I think, from Roger Ebert's Movie Guide. It was a Roger Ebert's Video Companion, and he gave the movie 3.5 stars. He wrote, Yeah, it's in my book
because I got that every year, so I probably read that.
Yeah,
I didn't
he wrote okay.
I was reading.
At the Telluride Film Festival, where I saw Henry in September of '89, some said the film was too violent and disgusting to be endured. Others said it was justified because of its uncompromising honesty in a world where most horror films cheapen death by trivializing it. The division seemed to be between those who felt the film did its job brilliantly and those who felt its job should not have been done at all. He went into some of the film's checkered history, and he defended the movie. And I know we have consternation for Ebert sometimes, but encouraging people to see this movie is one reason to admire him. I don't care what anybody says. I learned a lot about making movies reading his reviews, as well as Danny Peary's Guide for the Film Fanatic, which is out of print, but I managed to secure a copy of the book recently.
I'll give him that too. Okay, but and don't forget Joe Bob Briggs's movie book, The Midnight.
That's also awesome. I have that as well.
I love that book.
Our next movie is named Henry, Portrait of a Serial Killer, and wherever this film has been shown, it has shocked some people and impressed others. Even though it's been refused an R rating by the ratings board, it refuses to disappear. It's been around for 4 years. It couldn't be released originally because it couldn't get the R rating, but after playing at unrated midnight shows in Chicago and New York, it surfaced last fall at several film festivals and was taken so seriously by the critics that now it's going into limited national release, even despite the MPAA rating controversy. The film stars Michael Rooker in a performance of absolutely riveting brilliance as a flat-voiced, unemotional mass murderer who talks about his deeds almost in the abstract.
Well, my Aunt Marlene got me this book, Guide for the Film Fanatic, which I completely destroyed because I read it over and over again, and I found it. I found a used version from Amazon for like $5, and I love it.
cool.
It's a fantastic book, but nobody buys books anymore. It's sad.
I know. I still have a ton of them. Like, they just take up space, but you know, I mean, not that I don't refer back to them every once in a while, but you know, it's a lost thing, books.
And also,
but, there's a funny story about that Telluride screening that the first screening, like a bunch of people walked out during the home invasion, and then more people started hearing about it, less people started walking out.
Mm-hmm.
But McNaughton and Michael Rooker were there to answer questions about, you know, the movie afterward. They're going to do a little question answer period after the movie. So right. Like they're out hanging out, getting a drink and blah, blah, blah. And they come back to check, see where the movie is. And it's the home invasion scene, and they peek in, and then they see this woman pop up, and she's like coming for the door. There's only one walkout in this thing. Yeah. And Michael notices this, and he's like, I'm only going to get one chance at this. So he's like, this woman comes out of the door, and he just goes at her, goes boo.
Oh my god. And she probably freaking died. No,
he had to hug her and apologize.
No, sweetie, I'm an actor. I'm an actor. Like, that's
like,
not
really
real.
A nice guy. Like, but like, can you imagine? Oh my god, what a story.
You know what? I just at the beginning of every question and answer session, and Michael Rooker and McNaughton have to get up there on stage and grab the mic and say, "I just want to explain to everybody that what we did here, this is a movie. Okay, it's called Make Believe. It's not real.
It's not real. Yeah."
Yeah, I mean, it's just wow. It's just you know, I'm glad that we're talking about this tonight, because it's an exorcism. We never have to really talk about the movie anymore. But it took 4 years before the movie was granted any kind of theatrical exposure, which was all that mattered in those days if you wanted to get your movie seen. So by then, everybody moved on. McNaughton had already made his next movie, The Borrower, which we'll be looking at in a second. A couple of years later, I saw a movie called Sea of Love. We talked about this earlier.
Right.
It was a big hit. You remember it, obviously. Yeah.
Absolutely.
Al Pacino in a transitional piece directed by Harold Becker.
It was a year earlier than this came out. It was 89 that came
out. Yes. Nobody knew. He was in it. But the thing is, I know that Becker and Price were like, we got to get this guy when they saw Michael Rooker. Though Price would later write Mad Dog and Glory for John McNaughton. But Sea of Love, actually, I enjoyed it. I enjoyed it quite a bit. And I enjoy
Sea of Love, too. It's just
you mentioned it earlier about how it makes no sense.
It really does. It's so bad.
Well, okay. Like, the thing, what do you got? You got Al Pacino. He's completely he's like in Dog Day Afternoon mode, right?
I know.
And he hears the song Sea of Love. He's in the room with Ellen Barkin. Ellen Barkin went to the bathroom or something. And he's covered in red light or something. This is what I remember most about the movie, is that he's like, oh, shit. Oh, my God. Ellen Barkin's the killer. I'm going to have to fucking, oh, my God.
I remember sex scenes with him, and like, seriously, Al Pacino in a sex scene.
Is it obvious that Ellen Barkin is using a body double, because we never see her face with the rest of her body?
I was
happy
with the body double. I thought the body double had a hot body, and I really didn't want to see Ellen Barkin. Everybody, Ellen Barkin was one of those people. It's like everybody's, oh my god, she's so hot. I'm like,
I don't know. You know, Ellen Barkin is like, she's not, I don't know, there's something about her. She's just not attractive.
She's got a face that looks like she just smelled something bad all the time.
I wouldn't go that far, my friend. I would just say that, yes, I would probably, if there was enough red light coming into the bedroom, maybe I could.
Well, you know, Harold Becker made sure that there was.
But anyway, in Sea of Love, as soon as I saw Michael Rooker, I knew he was the killer. Sorry to spoil that for you.
Fucking swinging! How do you think, man? Keep those fucking court order. That's your family. That's your daughter. Oh my god! Don't! On the bed. You're on the bed, man. Go down.
So tell me, man, did you have a good time with her last night?
Who are you talking about?
Who are you fucking home, man?
I don't know who you're talking about.
I'm talking about my wife, man. My wife, Helen. You remember her, don't you?
I don't know.
Look, I'm in New York City.
I know who the fuck you are. You just show me how you did it.
You know?
Yeah. Now, spoiler also, alert. Thanks, man.
Rooker, Rooker also.
Goodman, man.
A couple of years later, Rooker also played the killer in Sisterhood of the Traveling Pants.
Because you know I'll always love you no matter what.
Yes.
You are now listening to Extreme Cinema with Andrew LeGank and David Lawler.
Let's all go to the lobby. Let's all go to the lobby. Let's all go to the lobby to get ourselves a treat.
Delicious things to eat.
The popcorn can't be beat.
The sparkling drinks are just dandy. The chocolate bars and the candy. So let's all go to the lobby to get ourselves a treat. Let's all go to the lobby to get ourselves a treat.
Can we talk about Mad Dog and Glory for a minute?
Do we have to?
Yes, we have to. I'm sorry.
Damn.
It's a podcast.
All right, Mad Dog and Glory.
I love this movie. I love it so much. I bought the Laserdisc and I still have it.
I don't like this movie. I don't like it so much that I don't own it.
Bear me out then, because I'm going to talk about how I think it's brilliant. This is the difference, I think, between men and women. Guys tend to like this movie a lot more than the ladies. My wife doesn't like
pussy.
This movie at all.
The hero's a giant pussy.
He's supposed to be a giant pussy. His name is Wayne. Sorry for everybody out there named Wayne.
Sorry, Wayne.
Waynes of the world, I am sorry. Party on.
Wayne's World, party time, excellent.
Dude, they're gonna take a contract out of your ass.
But this is the one thing I really remember. Is that when I watch this movie, and I watch it with people, you know, I watch it with women, and they say, this is such a sexist piece of shit with, you know, it's all about macho, it's all about men trying to be men, and it's women are property and all this.
Better and, women, dude. Get around, like, women that don't suck.
That would be very, very difficult. Sorry. But no, actually, Bronwyn doesn't hate the movie for that reason. She just doesn't like the character. She doesn't think that De Niro and Murray are you know, enough.
That Bronwyn was not one of the women you were talking about that had that attitude about the movie. I knew that already.
Bronwyn doesn't tend to get, like, she doesn't get angry. She doesn't get angry. She doesn't get livid about shit.
She doesn't strike me as the type who's going to sit there, I didn't think this because of feminist women.
No, definitely. She's not like that.
Yeah,
but, Ebert, incidentally, gave the movie 3.5 stars. He wrote, the movie's very funny, but it's not broad humor. It's humor born of personality quirks and the style of the performances. Vincent Canby also liked the movie.
And it has, like, your standard, like, Richard Price makes no sense. It's like, well, all of a sudden, Wayne walks into the police station and there's a mob boss just sitting there chilling with all the cops, eating fucking cheesecake.
Yes. I think it was pineapple cheesecake.
Yeah, pineapple, sour cream, cheesecake.
Yeah.
And everybody's acting like this happens all the time. And that's like a Richard Price-ism right there.
Well, it's
and
a,
like
it's,
you buy it until you take a
what
step
I
back
think
and you
is,
look at it and go, what the fuck? Like,
what I think a Richard Price-ism is the idea that women are kind of like property, because this is sort of how he writes. He writes in these big kind of broad brushstrokes, I guess, with regard to male and female characters, because you have Uma Thurman, and she's looking really gorgeous in this movie, and she plays Glory, who is into, I guess, Bill Murray's character for debts racked up by her brother, and De Niro saves Murray's life in a hole-up at a bodega, and Murray rewards him with possession of Glory for roughly a week, and the Wikipedia description refers to it as personal services. Which is really fun. De Niro falls in love with Uma and decides to liberate her from Murray's clutches. Now, we want to talk about the love scene for a second, because the thing about it is, yes, maybe it looks unattractive to you, but the reason that it looks unattractive is because it kind of looks real. It looks like a real sex
scene. Yeah, but I don't want to watch that. I don't want to watch two real people with their bony skin and their moles and their paley, pasty face shit and like and their weird expressions and their odd positions.
But she looked, like, I mean, like, the thing is, he really did look like he was making love to her because she was reacting in the way that it often is. It's not like saxophone music, and it's not like slow dissolves with big-titted women thrusting.
I'm not big on love scenes at all these days, but like at the end of the day, seriously, just kind of like you could do a lot more with a lot less. There's no need for us to linger on that.
I think that's
part of the problem is it doesn't really know what it's doing, and the characters occasionally behave in weird ways that don't make sense. Wayne is odd. How cringeworthy was it when the guy when you know the aforementioned police station cheesecake scene, mm-hmm. like when he's so mean to this guy really for no reason, and you know that he's making an enemy out of this guy, and there's no reason for anyone to do that.
That might have been because he got a little bit of the story. He doesn't like the idea of Bill Murray, you know, palming off Uma Thurman on him, and also it looks
Fear at play. There needs to be some fear at play there of what could happen, what kind of reprisal there will be if you're going to treat this guy like shit like that.
Story isn't so much that De Niro is like a timid or meek guy. Maybe he is brave.
Look what she's doing to us, man. Look what she's doing to our friendship, man. Like, quit.
Stay down, Wayne.
Stop it! This is stupid. He'll kill you sooner or later. I'm going with him. What? Come on, Frank. Come on.
No.
It's not up to you. Come on.
No, you're not.
Yes, I am.
No, you're not. It's over.
It's not over till he says it's over, Wayne. Come on, Frank.
No.
Now, come on. Let's go.
Shut up. Take her and choke on her.
What?
I wash my hands on both of you. It'll make my therapist very happy.
You know, maybe that is. I mean, that's what we ultimately
quivering
come to.
Quivering vagina.
Well, McNaughton wants to tell personal stories, much like our pal Rowdy Harrington. He's not into epic statements or anything. So,
dude, if Rowdy Harrington had done Mad Dog and Glory, it would have been way better. It
would have been a lot bloodier.
Way
absolutely.
Fucking hotter. Like, Uma Thurman would have been hotter. The sex scene would have been better. Like, I mean, come on. He would have been wall-fucking her and like that. Like...
Yeah. You're my new Saturday night thing.
yeah.
But there's like a lot of fist fights. There's plenty of fighting. It's interesting. I thought it was just an unusual take on the male logic, and it was casting against type. I wanted to ask you, would it have been better for you if they had switched roles?
I don't know. I think Murray was part of the problem. I don't know. There were issues all over the place. This movie, it's really hard to pinpoint. I know that I'm not nuts about the script, but I also feel that way about a lot of Richard Price's stuff. So I don't think that was really the issue. But I think that they had difficulty establishing the tone of the movie. Were they going to be a comedy? Were they going to be lighthearted? Was it going to be serious? And it could go off in any direction. And McNaughton himself says that he likes to do that kind of stuff.
Okay, let's move on to The Borrower. Not to be confused with the delightful John Goodman children's romp, The Borrowers. That's
a completely different
movie.
Totally different. Although John Goodman is in Sea of Love, even though that has nothing to do with anything.
Yeah, oh my God, there's a Goodman connection there. 6 degrees, baby.
There is. 6 degrees of John Goodman.
What do we got?
Thanks to Warlock and Hellraiser, the horror genre is hot again.
Isn't that something?
Now, from the critically acclaimed director of Henry, Portrait of a Serial Killer, comes The Borrower, a new kind of horror film.
There ain't nobody gonna believe this.
An alien serial killer from another universe comes to Earth.
Weird.
It's
the monster.
And Ray Don Chong is the detective who must find him.
Oh, my God.
Not since Reanimator has there been such a movie. The Borrower, the ultimate head trip.
Kind of cute. Kind of.
John McNaughton's The Borrower.
Now, The Borrower, I think, is the kind of horror movie that the Ali brothers would have wanted. But this was made by, you know, Atlantic did it, but then they went out of business, so Canon picked it up, and it wound up being a Canon film. How about that?
Yeah, so Atlantic apparently found some shitty script about an alien who borrows people's heads to survive and says, you know, we need to make this movie because of cocaine and shit. So, like, you know, they're like, McNaughton's kind of hot on coming off Henry. Dude, nobody would have greenlit this movie without a lot of cocaine, okay?
Well, I don't know. You know what? You were talking about this. Let me.
They were record execs, and record execs, like they're the numerous forays by record companies into the movie business have rarely ended well. And they're largely drug fueled,
I'm thinking
ego fueled messes.
I'm thinking Casablanca. Mm-hmm. Record and Film Works, okay?
Right.
They put out a couple of movies, and then, of course, cocaine. Yes, there was bowls of cocaine everywhere.
So they hire McNaughton, and that goes into pre-production. And then they kind of, like have second thoughts, and they're like, you know, dude, I don't know if you can really make a movie about a guy borrowing heads, because that's going to cost – we don't think you can do it for $2 million, man. I don't think you can make this awesome movie about borrowing heads for
I didn't get any budget information. Was that the budget for it?
$2 million, yeah. Yeah.
Well, it looks pretty good. I got to say,
they
looks great.
Actually pulled the plug on the movie because they thought that they couldn't get it done for $2 million, and then they came down – and woke up the next morning, and what they did was they shot like I think 11 pages it was, and they had already shot it, and they fire McNaughton, and then they rehire him after they look at what they shot.
Right.
After they sobered up.
Fuck you.
So McNaughton brings on Richard Fire, and they start rewriting this script into and now after that, the other original writer, apparently, like, he was very unhappy that they fucked up his head borrowing script and made it into another head borrowing script.
That
and
is like, not like, what I wrote. Yes,
this is not the head borrowing script that I wrote. I won't have my name associated with this. Alan Smithy is my name. It's an epic opus.
This is a bizarre movie. I remember first seeing it. It was chopped to hell, no pun intended, back on the Sci-Fi channel a while back. I think I even saw it before I saw Henry. My mother actually says to me, Davey, she used to call me Davey, I saw this movie. It was absolutely disgusting, but it was great. You would love it. It's called The Borrower. So we were talking about Jack Shoulder a couple of episodes ago.
Yes, and this movie does remind me of The Hidden a little bit.
Yes, you described The Hidden as being one of the better Terminator ripoffs, and I suppose The Borrower fits into that subgenre too, right?
It's clearly inspired by The Terminator, a lot of it, yes, and it does, definitely.
We don't have a double bill anymore. We have to do a triple bill of Dead Heat, The Borrower, and The Hidden.
This is crazy.
I know they did a lot of rewriting of the script because what's her name? Dredon Chong really was not happy.
No, they kept
changing things around in order to try and make her happy. And apparently that's why it looks like it's some disjointed mess where, like, she worked there for 2 days and had nothing else to do with the rest of the story. They probably could have cut her out and it wouldn't have made
it's almost like two movies where we're watching the story of the borrower. And then we're watching this kind of like subplot involving Dredon Chong.
And this guy
seemed like the writer was writing scenes for her.
Like, you forgot, I forgot about this dude that's, you know, in this, he's under arrest at the fucking hospital or whatever.
Oh, you're talking about the rapist, I call it.
Yeah, the rapist guy escapes and, like, you know, and like that guy was the most disturbing thing in it. Like, more than
I thought the eating of the mouse in the soup at the soup kitchen.
Soup kitchens in general kind of give me a skeevy feeling. I don't really like soup.
I had made myself a sandwich and I was sitting down to eat it when I put on the movie. I just put the sandwich aside and didn't want to look at it.
That said, I'm not hungry anymore. Yep. You know what's weird about The Borrower is that, like, you know, like this guy is supposed to be like this homicidal maniac killer that they've de-evolved to come down to Earth. But he doesn't seem to mean anyone any harm at all. He just wants to wander around and get fucked up.
Yeah, that's true. That's why it reminded me of The Hidden a lot because of the, you know, he seems very nice.
Yeah, he kind of is cool. Like, he just chills out. He just, like, kind of observes.
He's just like, by the way, you know, my head is kind of hurting. I'm going to have to take your head. That's just...
Yeah, unless he needs a head, he's just chilling and watching and hanging out and talking to people. That's it.
He's an alien criminal. This is, like, it's kind of funny because before the credits begin, and the music actually isn't terrible, there's this weird alien creature with a voice modulator. And he says that he's being sent to Earth as punishment for his crimes instead of execution.
Your sentence has been adjusted.
What?
The tribunal decided that in your case, execution was too lenient. Too kind an end for a murderer of such voracious appetite. You've been genetically devolved.
What?
Genetically devolved. This is your punishment. The worst sentence we could pass. You're a human being now.
A human being?
Yes. A primitive life form occupying the savage planet Earth. We will land there soon, and you will be left. Banished. A generous action on our part.
Right. And then we see Tom Towles again. There he is. He's playing another white trash drifter with his kid or something, and he grabs a potato. Does he have a potato gun? Is that what that is?
No, it's a silencer that they've made out of a plastic bottle.
But it is a gun. It's an actual gun.
Yeah, it's a rifle. It's like a hunting rifle. They were supposed to be hunting. Why they needed a silencer, I do not know. They won't explain. I don't know why they did that. Like, there's a lot of unexplained shit. Yeah. The borrower, man.
There certainly
is. It's the borrower. Forget it, Dave. It's the borrower. All right? Like, just forget about it.
So what happens here? The alien criminal appears. He punches Tom, sends him some 20 feet, and then the alien's head explodes, which is completely normal. Headless alien removes or borrows, as the case may be, Tom's head and puts it on his shoulders. So I'm just going to take this, and I'll give it back to you when I'm done with it.
But not before he sends his quote-unquote son, who looks absolutely like him, out because he wants to sell the dead body with no head.
Yes.
He's like, somebody will give us a
like
few
you
bucks
do.
For
this
it. Go get the van. Go get the van.
So this is what we do when we have a dead body minus a head. We sell it.
Yeah.
Radon Chong. It's great to see her. I knew eventually we would get the Radon. I love her. I think she's crazy hot. She plays a cop, tough as nails, and she always gets her man.
You wouldn't shoot me.
Try me.
In the back.
You ain't got the fuck!
You have the right to remain silent.
Leg.
Anything you say can and will be used against you. You have a
God.
Right to a
turn. What's the matter with you?
You can't afford
you're in big trouble.
Yeah.
I thought it was interesting. They decided to write a prototypical strong female character.
It's interesting. She wanted to be the star of the movie, and really, at the end of the day, the monster was the star, and that was where the source of the friction
came. But she does
get
top billing.
She did, yeah, but she wanted to really... Apparently, she had higher hopes for the head-borrowing movie. She thought that the head-borrowing movie was going to be a different movie than it was.
I guess, you know, this isn't the script my agent sent me. What are we doing?
Yeah, like, my agent sent me a much better head-borrowing movie
than the one I read was a work of art. What is this? So he's stumbling around with a wobbly head, and he reminds me of a Weeble. You remember those from Play School?
Yes.
Weebles wobble, but they don't fall down.
They weebles wobble.
Hey, hey, look at me and Weeble. Weebles wobble, but they don't fall down.
It's a nice bit of physical acting on his part. We don't think about it because Tom Towles looks like any guy you ever see in the street. You know, he doesn't look like a movie star. I can't imagine him complaining because he didn't get his water or something like that. Then there's this.
I'm surprised he actually never worked more because he would have made like a good, like, you know, just cop in the background. But he always has this skeevy thing, probably from being in Henry that always puts that like skeevy thing.
Yeah,
in your head.
Yeah. It's like Rooker, too. I mean, Rooker, you know, you look at him and you're thinking, this guy's going to kill me or something. I don't know.
Yeah.
It's just crazy. You know, he disappears into a role. He does what an actor should do.
It's supposed to be Chicago, and at this point, at least, it's L.A. they're shooting.
L.A., yeah.
I'm looking at this, I'm like, where are they? Like, and I check, and because it looks like L.A., like, and I'm like, you know, and I know that McNaughton is a Chicago filmmaker, so I look at IMDb, and they're like, yeah, filmed all in Chicago, and I'm like, yeah. Because this looks like fucking Hollywood Boulevard with no stars on the.
I don't. You know, the thing is, there's some beach scenes, something that looks like a beach, right?
Was there a beach? Yeah, there was a beach.
Yeah, toward the end of the movie, somebody's out at the beach. And it could be L.A. or it could be Lake Michigan.
And he's just sort of fascinated by everything he sees, and he really doesn't mean anybody any harm. He kind of wants to be friendly with everybody, and that's weird.
There's like this kindly homeless man played by Antonio Fargas, who was Huggy Bear on Starsky and Hutch.
This movie needed more Antonio Fargas, I think. You know,
he gives Tom some clothes, and this reminds me of the scene in Young Frankenstein with Gene Hackman as the blind man offering soup to Peter Boyle.
It kind of reminded me of Life Stinks more so than...
Life Stinks. A lot of things stink. Right. So the cast is inundated with all these conventionally unattractive people and the repulsive, nauseating subject matter. So every time the camera flashes on Ray Dawn, she's like a work of art. She is truly gorgeous in this movie.
She wouldn't have to worry about no titties for the rest of her life, boy. You know, she was set and she was looking good, son.
Yeah, she's like juxtaposed against, you know, Tom Towles dripping blood out of his fucking, you know, out of his throat and Antonio Vargas.
Yeah, there's a lot of ugly people in this movie, but she is not one of them. So she interviews Towles' son, the former Towles, not the alien Towles, and
good who's performance with him. From that kid, by the way.
I think he overacts wildly.
A little bit.
He screams, "Fuck you! Fuck you! You think I'm crazy?"
Oh, look, I know I sound crazy. I don't know if I believe it myself, but it's true, and we deserve that money. We discovered it. My dad would have wanted it that way.
Let's cut the bullshit, kid. What the hell were you doing in the forest preserve?
Fuck you! You think I'm crazy, right? Would that make everything better if I was crazy? Is that it? Would that make things better?
Okay. All right, Kip. We just need to know what happened.
Fuck you!
I was like, man, this dude, like, he's really up in this role.
But he kind of reminds me a little bit of Tim Roth, you know, where Tim Roth says, "Fuck you! I'm fucking dying here!
I'm dying!"
So Tom and Fargas, they sleep with other homeless people and they haunt the soup kitchen. This is interesting because Fargas is asked for a dollar and he actually says, "What do I look like, Donald Trump?"
Yeah.
He's like, "If you get your mouse in your soup, you get to keep your mouse in your soup."
Yeah.
That was just the grossest freaking thing I think I ever saw. So this is like, I was thinking it's a back alley version of The Hidden with the homeless used in place of yuppies. This is how I saw it. I wonder how similar Bob, the alien and Henry Lee Lucas are. You know, they seem to be drifters. Tom drinks liquor.
Yeah.
And he borrows Antonio Fargas's head. Like, excuse me though, sir. I was wondering if you could loan me your head. I need a head.
Pardon me.
Do you have any Grey Poupon? But of course. So the young punk Ray Dawn injured earlier strangles and we assume rapes a lady cop in the hospital. But the lady cop isn't dead. He wears her uniform and her bra. He puts on lipstick and he says, "Darling, you look marvelous," which is cute.
What the, like, and this is where we've slipped into another movie here that has nothing to do with the movie that we're in. It's kind of like, I feel like we're in an Ed Wood movie where, like, pull the string, you know, like we're going to have like Bela Lugosi show up or something. Like, it's like it's very disjointed in that regard.
This is terrible. This is just a terrible scene, and I it doesn't really belong. I think it's a little too much.
It's kind of like, it's one of those things, it's like after Henry, it's like maybe John McNaughton is a fucking psycho, you know, like he takes some sort of pleasure in this. That was my thought when I first saw it. I was like, because this is like, what the fuck? Like, this has no place here at all. Like, what is he doing kind of wallowing in this?
Right.
You know, like, and I don't understand. I still don't understand what he was going for there. He was obviously establishing that this guy was a really bad guy. For what purpose, I really don't know, because that whole subplot could have been cut out and wouldn't have made a difference.
Yeah, it would have. That's the problem. And it's, you're probably right on the money when you say that maybe Ray Dawn had issues and she wanted more of her character doing things or being involved in some kind of a different subplot, just to kind of, I don't know, give her more screen time or something like that. Because it doesn't seem consistent with the rest of the movie. I feel like it was shoehorned in.
Go figure, you know. I mean, you sign up for a head-borrowing movie, and it doesn't work out the way you thought. I mean, you know, like, you think you're making the right choices in your career, and things just don't go your way.
Well, another interesting item here. Thank you for that thought, by the way.
Yeah, no.
Is that the heads the alien chooses to wear all bear ballpark resemblances to each other for some reason.
They do. Well, until we get to the F. Murray Abraham stunt double.
That's exactly what I wrote here. I wrote he's a stand-in. And F. Murray. Yeah, his name is Tony Amendola. He's like doing his nurse, which right. is hilarious. And Fargus stumbles in. We see the boom mic a couple of times in the shot. The nurse rushes out. The
doctor, boom mic a few times.
Yeah. He loses his head. And he was in an episode of She-Wolf of London, which was a favorite show of mine. And he was on an episode of Seinfeld as Saul Bass, a man Kramer is convinced is actually Salman Rushdie.
He kind of looks like the soup Nazi. Like, that.
No heads for you. So once you get into like the disgusting vibe of the piece, it's a lot of fun. And then I see beautiful Match and Amick outside of Salmon's house.
Isn't it
trying
cool
to get
how
his
they,
attention?
Like, they changed it like obviously like they changed it into like a Miami Vice Manhunter. As a matter of fact, obviously I've heard McNaughton talk about how influential the book Red Dragon was on
really?
Henry. Oh. Yeah, and it was a big influence on him at the time. And obviously for a certain part of the borrower, he starts borrowing from Michael Mann in Manhunter. Hmm. There's a lot of it in the Imagine Amick part of the story. Once he goes to the doctor's house, and it's all like they've even got like a Jan Hammer score thing going on there, like
for, kind of yeah,
you know, and like it's and it kind of just goes off in this odd direction like that, and
it goes completely off the rails. You think you're watching, like you don't quite know what it is you're watching, and maybe you know. If there are tone issues, this is where I would put them in, because it feels serious for a little, and then it feels stupid, and then it feels funny, then it feels serious again.
Yeah, really.
You know, it's like, we introduced Madge, and she's like trying to get his attention, and he ignores her. I'd say his head wasn't on straight. Thank you very much. We get into the familiar hidden-like territory, because the doctor attempts to assimilate. He looks in his fridge, he takes out a raw egg and eats it. He shakes hands with his dog, but his dog growls. Dogs don't like aliens.
Right.
And then we go back to Madchen, and she's photographing. She's doing a music video for a hard rock glam band.
Yeah, this fat dude.
And the lyrics are, kill your mother, kill your father, kill my daughter, or something.
Yeah, yeah.
Now, I had a very dear friend. Her name was Laura, and she didn't like heavy metal music, and she constantly referred to it as kill your mother, kill your father music. And meanwhile, there's a couple, I guess, on the block or something, and they're watching the bizarre puppet show on TV, and I think it's supposed to be garbage.
Yeah, that was where it's like, what did I write? Like, because it's like it turned into Miami Vice with Garbage Pail Kids.
Yeah.
It was a music video with Garbage Pail Kids. Like, how the fuck, what the fuck just happened? We can't do anything by
working with each other. I ain't gonna work for free. Tell me what's in this for me. We can't do anything by working with each other.
Come on, kids, take a shot. Show them what we really got.
Yeah, I know. We flipping back and forth. What the hell is going on here? I mean, I'm like watching this and I'm like, what the...
Like, and like, what are these puppets that they're watching? What the fuck is that? Like,
it's bizarre. It's just you can't, you know, I think maybe they were at the end of the shoot and McNaughton was like, let's have some fun.
Let's have some fucking puppets to this movie. We don't have any puppets. This movie needs more fucking puppets.
Add puppets, always. Yeah. That's rule number one. So Madchen is talking to the band after they finished their wonderful music video, and she says, I love this line. She says, I like your new song. It's stupid. This gets hilarious all of a sudden. The doctor attacks the band, but guess what? His head is gone and replaced with that of the dog.
Of the dog.
And he's got a dog's head on.
And then he does like a run thing, like the end of Manhunter, like a, like where like I mean, obviously, like the influence of Manhunter is obvious in this.
Yes, and Citizen Kane, and the Magnificent Ambersons, and yes, the Sisterhood of the Traveling Pants.
Because you know I'll always love you no matter what.
No, no, don't forget the one where Charlton Heston plays a Mexican.
Touch of Evil.
Yes, Touch of Evil. Absolutely. Yeah, that's in there too. Yeah.
Imagine, okay, you were telling me this before, but I'm going to ask again. Can you imagine financing this movie?
Yeah. No.
And then we're going to put a dog's head on him at the end.
Yeah.
This is fucking brilliant. Take my money and make this movie.
Please, take my, are you sure you can do it for $2 million? And please pass the cocaine.
But seriously, pass the cocaine. Pass it over here right now.
Pass it quick before I change my mind. Yeah.
I'm still on the image of the guy with the little dog's head on.
I know. Like you're hearing this weird noise too. But you're hearing this weird noise coming from over there, and this dude thinks he's like the man going over there and like with a hose to like spray the dog. Yeah, he's going over the fence with the hose, and it's like, holy shit, this creature just falls down the fence. The fucking dog's head on and like a human body, which
yeah,
by the
human
way,
body's wearing
course,
khakis and a shirt, and he's got a dog's head with floppy ears.
Yeah, you know, like they could have picked anybody to play this guy at the beginning, but they had to pick this guy who's like a giant, a skinny, muscular, like kind of like not fat, not skinny, but well built.
He
no
looks
fat,
like he should be doing
like guy
in the
at
park.
The beginning. He's well, kind of
the guy at the beginning, yeah.
Yeah, and like so he's a big, tall diesel dude, and nobody else who plays this role is that way at all. And then by the end, they just don't care anymore. And F. Murray Abraham's stunt double has a big belly, and he's short, and like they just don't give a shit.
But you know, don't let our laughing dissuade you from seeing the. But it's worth it just for that. I think.
No, guys, just go to your wife and say, "Babe, tonight we're gonna order a pizza." Watch the bar of work. You're in there like swimwear. You're gonna get laid totally because everybody loves the bar of work. Like, dude, seriously, I'm telling you, cannot go wrong. Just tell him I sent you.
But the dog's head kind of makes up for a lot of it. This is how it starts. Ray Don is being pursued by the rapist asshole, of course, because this is part of the subplot. I don't know why it was written. It's so inconsistent. You can't have a guy with a dog's head attacking people and then get back to the rapist subplot.
Yeah.
Okay, that's just what is that?
Well, they brought him to the morgue, and then he attacked that funny morgue woman that was interesting and weird.
Oh wait, first she puts on this inappropriately sexy sleepwear.
Yes.
And there's no man in her life, so who is she wearing that for? Maybe
right.
She's eccentric. So
maybe
the
she
rapist.
Was wearing, she knew this dude was going to come in and do the. And he did the glass cutting just like fucking Manhunter. Just
also,
like fucking
also
Manhunter
Jack's
bitches.
And Jack's back as well. It was glass cutting, I think.
Yeah.
I'm not sure. Yeah, well, somebody smashed through a window, too. But she. Okay, he breaks into her house. He got her address somehow. He pets her dog, which is another weird bit. Ray Dawn wakes up, and apparently she has a gun secreted in her crotch, and she shoots him right through her sheets.
And they kind of make it look like it's like a weird – the way it's shot, the whole thing is weird because like they actually kind of edit it together. Like you're not sure whether she shot him or not, or there was somebody else there behind him. It was like that shot him.
It is,
like,
yeah.
You don't know.
It's a little awkwardly blocked, yeah.
Yeah, and then and it's also badly lit. And then you see her with the gun. Finally, what you could sort of make out as a gun, and you're like, okay, she shot it.
Dog boy winds up at the corner, right? Switches heads with the coroner, attacks Ray Dawn and her partner. This gets a little confusing because I'm not really quite sure how the hell this is happening.
Yeah.
He attacks Ray Dawn and her partner. Now, We forgot to mention her partner. She has like this old guy for a partner or something. He keeps telling her to get married.
We've seen him in a lot of shit over the years, and he has a name, but I don't remember what it is.
He's like obsessed with the idea of her quitting her job and getting herself a husband.
Well, they have to talk about something while they're sitting in the car wasting screen time, you know. Like, they have to pad it out to a feature somehow.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, like,
unfortunately, I think he dies, right? He gets killed by the borrower.
And then all of a sudden, the borrower turns into like the Terminator, where he's been getting shot and getting fucked up by shots the whole movie, and then like you shoot him and like it's like no big deal.
Yeah.
And so then the FBI shows up, because, and you know they're the FBI because they're wearing suits that don't fit them very well.
they keep flashing a badge, FBI.
Yeah.
FBI.
FBI.
And they're they're there to confiscate the body, and Radon's a bloody mess.
So they get like a 1978 ambulance from fucking like Cannonball Run or something, and they fucking load up.
Yeah, and Sammy Davis and Dean Martin are driving.
And Radon Chong is like covered in blood and like totally like.
No, I like this. I like this a lot, because we zoom in on her face. And then you don't know whether or not what you're seeing is actually happening or what she's imagining is happening. But we don't get like any reason for her to believe any of what she actually, because she doesn't really know as much as we know about what the hell is going on.
We also don't get any closure from this either. You know, I mean, which worked in Henry, but in this particular case, you know, this is a ridiculous story that kind of like, you know, you want to see, you know, it needs a beginning, a middle, and an end, and like the bad guy should die. You know, you don't just
We should have started it like that. Head. Oh my God, how funny! I mean, maybe funny and tragic at the same time. If Dog Face was trying to attempt to rape her. I mean, it's wrong, but it's so right. All right, so this is kind of like, I just wrote in my notes, this is kind of like if John Waters made a science fiction movie. Stuart Gordon on Any Given Sunday, but Stuart Gordon would never do the dog head.
No, Stuart Gordon would have done. Well, you know what else it reminded me of? There was a little bit of Basket Case in this movie.
Basket Case is a little bit funnier. Do you maybe get the indication that McNaughton was like, I don't feel comfortable with this being a complete comedy, even though it's ridiculous, but I'm not comfortable enough for it to be a serious movie, because people might think it's campy.
Definitely. I mean, I definitely get the feeling that he was a little conflicted about which way he was going to go.
I don't understand. He's reading the script. Okay, dog head? Yeah. You just had a rapist and you're putting a dog head. All right.
Yeah, I can see this first writer just going, I made this perfectly serious movie about borrowing heads, and now you've got to borrowing a dog's head, man.
Well, okay. This movie had its problems. It was shot in 1988, a full 16 years before The Sisterhood of the Traveling Pants.
I have no problem being mad at you,
because you know I'll always love you no matter what.
While Henry was languishing on the shelf. So Henry was going back and forth with ratings board, since it was deemed to be of a quality suitable for theatrical release. So The Borrower had the same problem. McNaughton said they had to resubmit the movie 5 times before they got the R rating.
Right.
And The Borrower was to be distributed by Atlantic, but they went out of business, of course. We talked about that. In some markets, the movie was retitled Alien Killer. So
I don't remember that. I do remember it being released, because Canon acquired it after, you know, Atlantic went into bankruptcy, and it actually was embargoed for a while. They couldn't do anything with it because it was part of the bankruptcy proceeding, and the judge had to say what they could or couldn't do.
Right.
But then once they finally did, Canon picked it up, and Canon, unfortunately, Canon really never showed much love for the shit that they picked up to distribute. If they didn't make it themselves, they kind of just dumped a lot of shit. They really weren't too big on that. So they didn't do a lot with it, but it did open in a midnight movie, and it's a perfect movie for that. Like, this I could totally see being a midnight movie that people would go see. And I did read about it in Fangoria before it came out. Fangoria was the best. I haven't read it in a long time, but it used to be the number one, my favorite movie magazine. It was like the most in-depth, best movie magazine there was. And unfortunately, it only focused on horror, because if they did as good a job focusing on everything as they did on horror, it would have been incredible. But nobody did, you know. Like, but they did great work.
I had I had a couple of Fingories. I think I have a couple that you lent me, actually.
Oh yeah, I used to read it religiously back in the day. But so Cannon basically ran it on the midnight circuit and then dumped it on video, and that was all she wrote, really.
Wow. Well, there's a couple of items I wanted to share.
Sure.
The photography, it's quite good. It was shot in 35. It looks really good compared to Henry. Henry's very, as we said, it's very murky.
Yeah.
And I didn't know the budget was $2 million. Actually,
it doesn't show.
No. So, again, we had McNaughton. He was getting some help from friends and family. There's a couple of people in there that were associated with Henry.
Right.
And Tracy Arnold, who played Becky in Henry, has a bit as a nurse in this.
Mm-hmm.
And
McNaughton seems to be a very loyal guy. He works. He likes to surround himself with people that he's familiar with. And he likes working with him. He keeps working with him. He's an interesting guy. You know, he's led an interesting life.
Yeah, he has an unusual and distinctive quality to him. I mean,
he sort of walked the earth for a while before he went back to Chicago to become a filmmaker.
He had like 100 jobs. He was like an Ernest Hemingway type. And then
he kind of got into
advertising too.
He traveled with a carnival for a while. He said that he learned a lot about, weird characters from that. And I can believe that.
Yes.
And he built boats in New Orleans. He basically sort of walked the earth like Kane and Kung Fu for a while.
Do you think that there are thematic similarities between Henry and The Borrower?
Unfortunately, there are thematic. No, but I don't know what he was going for. Why he went for like the Henry ending of fucking The Borrower, which is completely out of place. really thematic. Do you see any? I don't really.
The only thing I see is that we have two characters that kind of like walk between the shadows in places that most people don't go. We see, like, you know how in Henry we see a side to Chicago that we're really not, that we really don't
see. There's your thing. No
movies.
Law enforcement gets involved.
There is.
Like, seriously. This dude is walking around bleeding from his fucking head and nobody does anything.
We do see cops, though, in this movie.
We see cops, but they never do anything.
They never know.
Motherfucker gets shot right next to him in the fucking, in the diner, and nothing ever happened.
Yeah, and a cop gets raped in a hospital. And nobody helps her.
Yeah, I know. That scene really didn't belong. I don't know why they went there with that.
I don't know. Maybe he just wanted to make it real. He wanted to make it have a like a.
He was keeping it real.
Keeping it
real. All right.
So, all right. The subject matter is interesting enough, but I don't know if I were making the movie, I would take out that goofy beginning bit with the alien. Maybe go a little darker. I wouldn't do the humor thing. This is like, because it's like another body snatching kind of a story, or head snatching, as the case may be.
I think I would have thrown everything out. I would have made it like a sort of like a Frankenstein, where the alien comes and he's borrowing heads, and he falls in love with Radon Chon, the tough cop, and she has to like not only fend off his advances but like take him out as well.
That's good. I like that. There's conflict. At least, you know, there is actual conflict there. There's no conflict in this movie.
No, there isn't.
It's like the borrower tells his story and Radon tells hers, and they only meet at the end.
Yeah, I feel, you know, I just sort of feel like, you know, we could have learned more about the
about like, dog heads.
Like, what motivated the borrower to borrow? Like, why did he want to borrow? Like, why did he, yeah, like, you know,
maybe Radon has to take in the dog boy, the dog man.
What does it feel like to borrow?
So this, visually, it looks great. I think it has great exterior night photography that I'm always harping on about. Good colors.
It had nice night photography.
I like that kind of stuff.
Mm-hmm.
I don't like it. You know, I was thinking about it because I was writing my review for Slumber Party Massacre, and I was talking about night shots. They look
better
great.
You than me. Yeah, yeah.
I don't like when you can see every damn detail when it's supposed to be the middle of the night. This is just like the crew trying to justify their jobs. You know. So that's just how I saw it. Tom Towles is exceptional in the early parts of this movie. He's really fun to watch. So strangely, this is another movie I don't think I could ever recommend to anybody, much like Sisterhood of the Traveling Pants.
Because you know I'll always love you no matter what.
You know you want me, baby.
Yeah, I don't recommend that either. Or yeah, yeah. What was other one? The what is it, like Sisterhood of the Wu-Tang Clan or something? There's another one that sounds like that. It's like weird name.
Of the Wu-Tang Clan.
One of those old lady movies with like fucking, you know, with Kathy.
Oh, yeah,
Bates.
Yeah, I know what you're talking about. I know what you're talking about. It was like, oh God, but it wasn't Wu-Tang Clan. It was like,
I know.
It was like what was it? The something society, the Chaka Khan society, Wu-Tang Clan society, something like that.
Chaka Khan.
And they all yell the name.
Chaka Khan.
Yes.
Who's in it? Ellen Burstyn, somebody like that?
Chaka Khan.
Yeah, it's like Ellen Burstyn. Yeah, Ellen Burstyn. Yeah.
Please find the title now.
All right, I'm looking.
Because it's going to drive me nuts. It's like Habba Da Mubba, something like that. Bookity Boo, Kathy right. Bates, maybe?
Yeah, I think Kathy Bates is in it, too. I'm going for it.
The Chaka Khan Society, something like that. I don't know why, but I keep going back to Chaka Khan.
Chaka Khan.
The Boobly Boo.
Ya-Ya Sisterhood.
The Ya-Ya Sisterhood. There it is.
The Divine Secrets of the Ya-Ya Sisterhood.
That's
there
it.
You go.
The Divine Secrets of the Ya-Ya Sisterhood of the Traveling Pants.
You are now in the inner sanctum of the Temple of the Ya-Ya.
And they all say Ya-Ya or something, right?
Yeah.
We are the mighty Ya-Ya Priestesses. Let no man put us under. Now our blood flows through each other. As it has for all eternity. Loyal forever, we raise our voices in the words of Mumbo Gumbo. Ya-Ya!
It's like Ya-Ya, and they all bang on a dish or something like that.
Yeah,
and they do some New Age Wicca.
We have like Ellen Burstyn, and I thought there... Oh, Ashley Judd. And Cherry Joe.
Oh, Ashley Judd, who was in a movie directed also by John McNaughton with Luke Perry called Normal Life. I remember that one, too.
Yes, that was what he did after Mad Dog and Glory, which, you know, kind of... I hadn't even heard of that until, like, I was looking at his career.
It must have been, like, one of those direct-to-video or released-for-video type titles.
Yeah, which is an odd choice considering where he was at his career then. Like, you know, it's
yeah, I know he's
I know. Things don't always work out the way you want them to.
They never do.
I want to do a direct to video.
As a filmmaker, filmmaking is constant compromise, as they say. You know, I mean, it's like that's what Alfred Hitchcock said a long time ago, and he was a guy who wielded a lot of power. So,
yeah, indeed.
Hallelujah! Holy shit! Where's the Tylenol?
All right, let's wrap this up. This is a lot of fun, and I'm glad that we talked about it so that we never have to talk about it again.
Yes.
But eventually we will have to do Sisterhood of the Traveling Pants and the Ya-Ya.
Oh, we can do some chick flicks at some point, I suppose.
Chick flicks. Yeah, you know what? Nothing is more exploitative than a chick flick. Absolutely.
There's some of them that are pretty – they are kind of – particularly the one we were talking about earlier, Eye for an Eye. That one's fucking exploitative as fuck. Love it. It's awesome. It's like sleazy.
Well,
I guess we'll
be getting to that. We'll be getting to the work of John Schlesinger next time on Extreme Cinema. But before that, I guess Andrew has to have a baby.
I'm popping out a puppy. Yep.
No, don't say that. Not after what we just watched. Oh my God.
Yeah, really. No, yeah, no, yeah. Well, my wife is giving birth on the 29th, I believe. That's a tentative date, but that's when they're going to induce. So, yeah.
Apparently, Macy boy. Chimed in there too.
Yep.
Yep. Macy's well, we'll be side. Back, I guess. But by the time this episode airs, the child will be off in college.
Yes. The way you edit it. Yeah.
The way I edit. Yeah. All right, everybody. Good night.
Good night.
We have a new category this year. Best film ever made by a human being. I would like to say to all the people out there who told me not to make this movie.
Chaka Khan.
Who said no to me when I asked him for money. Who wouldn't even read the script or return a simple phone call. It's my favorite teacher at film school whose parting advice to me was to try and find a job somewhere teaching Spanish at a woman's college.
Chaka Khan.
And to Dolores del Sordo, the girl I loved, I mean, I really loved in high school, who left me for a junior varsity football player.
Chaka Khan.
To all these people, and many more, I would love to say thank you, but I can't. Because what I really feel like saying is go!
Oh no. Obviously, we just lost the satellite feed. That sucks.
You have been listening to Extreme Cinema with Andrew Legang and David Lawler.